they are mainly an engineering firm, so they had to go out and look for an architect if they didn't have one on staff, so that they could give a rate for that type of person. When we go to Crabtree, they are primarily architects, so they provide those services. They have some in-house people, but they would have to supplement that with other engineering firms outside. And that satisfies our bid specs. As long as we call them, they contact those engineers and provide those services to us seamlessly as if it was in-house.
That means like we more often need engineering services than
our. Agreed. And there was a lot of people that called us up and said, we would like to bid on this. It just isn't a good match. The people that did this building, KCPA, they said, we would really love to bid on this, but this time, with their workload, they said it just wasn't a good match for them to bid on this. They didn't think they'd be providing fair services for us based on the needs that we presented to them. Other companies like Boucher and James, they're typically a civil engineering. I talked to them, they were very interested in this, but they said they couldn't do it alone and they were looking for other partners. I know they were pursuing that, but it just didn't work out. And they said, we really wish we could have done this, but we can't fairly serve your needs. So they didn't submit as well. Other people like EI Associates, they do have a lot of in-house staff, but they don't have everything. But I don't know that any one of these firms have every single person in-house. So we're asking for an architect. Every type of engineer, structural, mechanical, that's a lot to ask for any firm to have in-house. But for the majority of the people that did bid, they had most of the services or partnered with one other firm or two, have all those under their umbrella. Does that answer your question?
Remington and Vernick, what are they?
Remington?
I just don't know that company.
Remington and Vernick, they are engineers. They're out of Conshohocken. And I believe they also do the same partnership that they partner with an engineering firm of people they didn't have in-house and architects as well.
And Reynolds is engineering. It's just because I know that company.
Correct. They're primarily engineering. But there was a lot of interest. I'd say with the six proposals we did receive, I received 4 to 6 calls from people that said they really wish they could provide the services that we were asking for. They either thought they weren't going to be competitive, it wasn't good timing, it wasn't a good match. There was a lot of interest in this project.
We received 39 requests for the RFP.
Wow.
Wow.
So was it, did we not give a long enough time period?
We gave them a month.
Is that a long enough time? I don't know. Because it's a pretty big proposal.
No one asked for more time, I can say that. I think they had enough time to hold.
So it wasn't a timing issue, it was.
Right, it was timing. Was their time that either their workload currently was too much or their foreseeable future, or they just didn't feel was a good match that they could adequately serve as vendors for this.
Are there any other questions about the matrix itself in terms of the information that came in or?
So maybe can you walk us through how you arrived at the numbers in yellow? What was your multiplier or factors?
So that's the simple part of this, is the weight. So we looked at understanding how much weight, we really want them to be in tune with us, know what we're looking for, we put 10% on this. If we look at the highest weights, it was tab 7. What are our totals here? 35, 40, 35. So that's the highest weight, the cost. And the biggest components of that was the initial assessment and our summer capital project management and development.
I believe Mr. Krause is specifically asking, like, if you look at the understanding totals, how do you get 1.4, 1.4, 1.9? What did you do to actually arrive at those numbers?
Right. So in Barry, Isaac, they scored a 3, and their 10% weighting on that is 1.4.
So there's formulas in this chart that I didn't make that we borrowed this matrix that I believe totals up at the end of the column 21, and then it's divided and it's turned into the 10% weight of that.
So they take 3 divided by the 21, and when you take 3 divided by 21, you get this 21.4, and then they multiply that by 10 to get you out of 100. So there's 1.4. So that's why these totals over here matter. The ones that are numerical are a little simpler.
The green columns are the radians. And bound.
Now, was I right? Because you just checked me.
He totally
I just put it out on the record.
Make sure
it's on the record. Then he appreciates it, but he's still checking.
Thank you, Doctor. Okay, I take check.
And the total at the bottom is the sum of those figures in yellow. I checked that already.
You didn't ask?
So,
nope.
You would say that you're going to explain how you arrived at the $4,000 plus 70%.
Yeah, right. So that's Dewey Engineering, and their cost for, so they have a range. So there's the $0 to $100,000 capital project value, there's a $100,000 to $300,000, and there's over $300,000. Each one of those have a different percentage and lump sum. So for me to fairly evaluate this, I took the sum of all of our capital projects and found out what's the average cost of one capital project over a five-year period. That number was, it's in here in green, $103,098. So I took that times 7%, added 4,000, came up with my percentage, divided it up so it's 7.04% based on our average cost of a summer capital improvement project.
For all the children watching at home,
you
will use that.
Yes, right.
When you grow up, maybe not.
Spreadsheets are fantastic. And the orange is the only thing that's somewhat subjective in this. Everything else is fairly evaluated. And again, the orange, that the Dewey number, the Remington, and the Reynolds, I had to plug information on based on, they didn't give me a standard answer in the proposal. And the bottom numbers, so Dewey was the highest, 68.03, and you can see the others in there. We have a lot of close seconds and thirds. So the goal of this is really to decide how many people you'd like to interview for this, to award this. It can be one, two. Do you want us to propose someone? Do you want to look into us? We brought all of the proposals with us, so if you'd like to take it home and get some fun reading tonight or over the weekend, you can certainly do that.
I'd like to kind of understand why why each one scored lower.
So we'll pick any one of these to some degree?
So maybe starting with the first one.
Good.
Like some have threes and some have fours.
So just everyone had a paragraph or a page to talk about what they believe we're asking for. As I read through them, some of them just didn't hit the mark exactly knowing what we wanted. Some of them knew exactly what we wanted. So four was the highest number. If I gave them a three, it was because they didn't seem to get the big picture of what we wanted.
So is it, how much of a pain would it be to make this chart instead of in numbers to make it words, right? Like, do you know what I'm saying? Like, this is what they're offering and this is in words instead of numbers. You know what I mean? Does that make sense? Like for the three represents, they didn't, this is what they were missing, right? And the four is that they got everything. And if we did that, I think it would be easier for us just to compare, because there's so many different categories that they're being, and then you can decide what things are important, right, and what things aren't as important. But I think if these six people, I mean, it's pretty extensive to submit all of this, and they're all pretty close. I would want to hear them all out, because I think a lot of this stuff, some of it's guessed, some of it's them guessing, and I would want to hear them all out and hear them explain why each one of them is, why they think that they can do a better job than the other ones. And then it's and then when we hear all of those reasons, I think it would be helpful to figure that out.
So you're asking for that as part of their interview process?
Yes.
Or the scoring?
Well, the chart thing would be outside of, the chart thing would be outside of interviewing them. Interviewing
right.
them would be a separate thing.
This is to help this group decide who do we want to bring back to have a face-to-face interview.
So to me, this takes out the emotion.
Yeah.
Right. This is the intent of this, is to take emotion out of the equation.
And I'll spin for you.
and strictly work with the numbers, right? The scoring, it's intent to take the ambiguity and emotion out of this. And I agree with you, right? You know, it narrows it down. It's like a funnel, right? So it's narrowing down the folks who would like to learn back from.
So the inflation, I know that they're guessing at that, but are they held to that in any way?
Yes, that's their plan.
Okay.
That's what's in their proposal.
All right. And then for references, so it's just purely the number of references received.
Okay.
And then that was given a 5% weight out of your total score.
Right, so that's important, but again, it's probably the lowest criteria.
Yeah, well, because you can't judge someone on the number of references that you receive.
Right.
All
these
are
good candidates. It's just how much better someone than another.
Well, I would, in my mind, the one you said Barry Isaac is architecture. He's an architect. Or is he an engineer? Thomas, one that was
EI's architecture.
Crabtree is an architect.
Crabtree, right?
So these guys are.
Well, your references, like,
but they're still going to have the engineering services.
They're
going to
have all the services.
All
it's whether they sell them out or
right.
they
sell them
in-house,
right.
Right. Relative
I mean,
to where, who they have,
to me.
And they
right.
subcontract out the work, well, whether it's architectural or engineering. Sorry.
Right. So either way, you're
anyone that subbed it out. When we looked at the people that they are subbing out to, they're good candidates as well.
But I mean, some of this is like you know when you're talking about whether they described our needs appropriately. How important is the thing that they didn't describe? You know what I mean? That to me is like, it's kind of subjective. A lot of these things are subjective. And when the numbers are this close, it's hard to really compare each of the different companies. I would want to give them all an opportunity. There's only six of them. I'd want to give them all an opportunity to plead their case and explain their proposals.
We're down to 6 from 39. That's the way I look at it.
Yeah, 6 is not that many.
But I'd rather be down to 3.
6 is a lot.
I'd rather bring 3 back.
I'd rather be down to 3.
Dr. Martin, did you say that did you say that the total score at the bottom is the adding of all of the yellow numbers?
Yes.
Okay. And Bill checked it.
Verified. Yeah.
So if we just took out the references, because I'm not comfortable with that, then we would just subtract whatever that is,
correct.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And really, the references beyond, I mean, it does, since Dewey did have a higher number, it gave them roughly a point and a half. So even if you subtracted a point and a half off of them, because the other companies are fairly equal. You know, Remington has a little advantage, but it's only half a point, quarter of a point. So it's not significant to the other five. But I agree with you when you look at it, because I think if we had said to Reynolds, hey, we want as many references as you can, they would have been as 32.
Well, that's
maybe.
What I'm saying. Like, you know, if you told me I need 3 references and then I gave you 25.
So a couple things that we talked through that I want to make sure we say out loud. First of all, and we said this when we went into the RFP process, right? Dewey is currently doing this work for us, and this is not an indication of the work that Dewey's been doing.
Right.
So I want to publicly say that as many times as we can.
Right.
That this is my recommendation that we look at services on a regular basis to make sure that we are getting the best price and the best service for the district, right, for what we're doing.
Yeah.
This especially is such a large ticket item every year in and year out. It is vital that this firm is the one that we, you know, feel is best for Pennington's needs. One of the pieces that we've had conversation about is engineering versus architectural. And so I do want to ask Mr. Harper, because he's had some experience with this with other districts, as to whether he has an opinion as to whether it matters and to what extent does it matter that you have an engineering versus an architectural firm. Because what I think I heard you say is it has to do with the difference of they have to work with people as opposed to it being in-house. My guess is the engineers would have to work with architects, but that is less of a need for the projects we're talking about, so there's less going out of the house.
Right.
And so from your experience before, as you looked at, you know, the two architectural firms, how big of a deal is that to you, and what would you have the board consider around that conversation or not?
I would say the ones that are primarily architects, that's a minus for me. We're primarily looking at engineering services. That's, I don't know if I could put a fair number on it, but probably 90% of what we're looking for here. The the architectural piece, while they might be good management of some of the engineers that they hire, you better have the engineers do the work and manage it.
Now, in your experience at the other districts you've worked in, have you ever worked with a primarily architectural firm for these services?
Yes.
And so you feel as though that model was inferior to the engineering model for what we're talking about within your experience?
Yes. Okay. My experience is the engineers, or the architect came in, did a study, and it had to be redone by the engineers 2 years later.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, that's helpful. In terms of
But that probably depends on the company, too, right?
And it depends on what kind of things you're looking for. If you're trying to renovate a building, or if you're looking at just capital improvements.
Right.
In my prior district, they let things go until it was a total renovation. That's more architectural. So that fits that profile, but they were also looking district-wide at all capital projects as well. So maybe that was a better fit for them.
And that's why here. I had heard some people comment before that they felt it would have been better to have someone architectural for a lot of the work that we had before, because it was more of those kinds of projects. But now that those things are built, it's more of an engineering focus.
We agree.
And I will tell you, KCBA struggled mightily with their engineering services when they built this building.
So that's
it was a problem.
Yep.
And they are primarily an architectural firm.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
Right.
That's
what I was clarifying.
Yeah,
no,
sure. That's absolutely
okay.
What they were.
Yeah.
But they obviously did. They went out for subcontract with engineering firms, and that was a real issue.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't the only issue in the building, but it was a real issue.
I think any time that you're going to say, well, we'll rely on them to go find the engineer, that's kind of.
So they could satisfy the bid specifications, but would it be an efficient process?
And that's my other concern, is that it's going to take a lot of time.
Right.
It could take more time.
So let me ask a question about Reynolds specifically. Was part of the bid requirement for them to provide a cost for the summer project fee?
Yes.
So that's essentially a no bid. You put a placeholder in.
I put a placeholder because they want. Their answer was we would negotiate that on job by job. Right. They did not give us.
I'm not comfortable with that.
Remember,
I mean, I understand that you can get better prices, but
remember, we're not going to be here.
I
understand.
Piece, that negotiation is generally a part of this process. It can be a part of this process, and that may be their standard in the way they do it. You know, they come back and do it on a per project basis and determine fees. So it's not that we ask for a specific bid in this process. Professional service.
Okay. Part of that was to provide a cost.
Part of it is what we asked for was cost. You're right in fact that
right.
Did not do that.
Right. So that's just my concern with that firm. You know, and again, they're wanting to negotiate it.
Yeah, like every time
yeah.
We have
right.
To.
I'm not in love with that concept.
Sure.
Could you find out from them, or did you already ask them, and maybe you said this, I'm sorry, what their could they go back and give you an example, like with this school district that we worked with that ended up being X percentage of their projects, summer
right.
Projects that
we worked. Did not communicate with them. We just merely scored this, brought it here. If that's something you want us to do,
that would be
we can reach
well,
out to them.
I mean, if you feel like there'd be value in seeing that from them, you read their proposal, like if you would want to hear more from them, then that would be one thing.
You look at the numbers that are in second place technically.
Yeah,
technically. Another thing I'll ask Dr. Yarnell, if I recall, weren't they involved with the tech school?
They certainly were.
So would you be willing to share the experience?
It was pretty ugly.
I just want to.
They have a reputation, as I understand, very good in some places and very awful in others. The folks at the tech school, Palisades had worked with them, they liked them. It was one of the reasons that they were at the tech school. I think a lot has to do with who's on the site at the time.
Agreed.
And we had someone who I don't think did their job.
And how many times did we have to pour the machining floor?
Three, maybe.
Others?
No, that's, I remember.
It was not pretty.
Yes.
So I won't vote for them.
Yes.
Just because of that.
So I share the experience.
If we want to interview them, fine, but if they're not going to be a choice, then I'm going to.
In full disclosure, I was on the tech school at the time, so I'm aware of this. That's why I asked if you would come up with
it. Well, and again, we have another situation where they were asked to give numbers and they didn't. I
So anyway,
I feel as though the board needs to make a couple decisions in terms, because one thing you could look at and say, we're happy with doing, we're done, right? They have the highest number, that is a possibility that we could move forward from that standpoint. It's not my personal recommendation, but no, I'm not sure we're at that stage yet, but in terms of, because I think it makes some sense to then talk to some firms to ask some of the clarifying questions you're asking. I think the board does have to make a determination as to whether they're comfortable talking to an architectural firm or firms or not, because that obviously does dictate in terms of what that looks like. One of the possibilities as you look at numbers is to figure out how many you want. One of the recommendations could be to interview a couple engineering firms and maybe one architectural firm to kind of see how you feel about the architectural and what those questions look like. You know, so you could look at Dewey and Reynolds, that from a numbers standpoint, they are the highest numbers. The next engineering firms are a little further behind them. And then the architectural firm that is, you know, that tied for second, third piece, but has low fees would be Crabtree and Rohrbach. That if you look at their pricing, their summer fees are the lowest. Mm-hmm. And so that is a numbers game where you're talking about costs. If you wanted to see architectural, you could include them. Spence Clemens has made the suggestion that perhaps you speak to all six of them and you bring them in. From a timeline standpoint, we have built in some time for interviews in May so that we could provide you with the information, get your clarifying questions, right? We can scan and send you any or all of the proposals. You know, maybe the proposals of the companies we decide to interview, we could scan and send them to you so you could review them, ask questions. Mr. Harper, Mr. Dalbert will probably be able to answer most of those questions, but if not, we could have those for the interviews. We would have them come in, maybe do a 30-minute presentation, have 15 minutes for question and answers. We're going to go back and forth and have a couple groups come in. We'd have to decide whether we do that on a night like this or whether we do a separate night. And that probably depends on how many firms you choose to bring in and how long you're willing to sit from that standpoint. So.
And we've done that before where we've had interview nights for different things, and then, you know, whatever board members want to come, and whatever ones don't, and, you know, sit through and do all the interviews. So.
Can I ask a question? Because some of these firms I know and some I don't. I know EI is basically out of Harrisburg. They're the ones who have done the demographic surveys for us prior to the most recent two, I believe, but they did a number of them. Reynolds is somewhere in the King of Prussia area, as I recall. Obviously, Dewey's in that one. And Mr. Isaac is, I believe, also local. But Crabtree and Rohrbach, where are they located? And do they have an office here?
Mechanicsburg. Most of these have small satellite offices scattered throughout.
And that is a concern to me. You know, it's not on the scoring rubric, but I do think that it's helpful that someone who at least is King of Prussia or Bethlehem, someone local, as opposed to halfway across the state.
The Department of Services is, do we have a problem? We want them to come out and look at it. They're likely going to charge travel time and all those other costs. They're just going to add up.
Well, it's interesting because when you look at their pricing, though, they give us the lowest price of all of them. So I would assume that they build in their travel time.
Yes, I wouldn't
assume. It's in their price. I mean, they can't say, I'm going to charge you this.
What is their average hourly rate? I don't see that you asked. You didn't ask them specifically
about
travel time.
Projects.
The bottom one is the projects, right? That's their administrative.
When you're looking at the hourly rate, that's not where the biggest chunk of your money comes in. The biggest chunk of the money that you pay is the percentage they charge on top of the projects. That's where your biggest, expense is.
The hourly rates are for supplemental services outside of the capital planning and the summer projects. We have a big crack in the wall out here. We think it's foundation. We would call someone like this in, the structural engineer, on a time and material basis. That's where that fee structure would apply.
Which is why it's only 5% of the weight. It is not a common occurrence, but you would have a one-off that you would need to account for.
Right, but when you're bidding out million-dollar projects and you're paying a percentage on that, that's where most of your money is going to be spent, not on that hourly rate to fix the crack out.
listed in our RFP, and I believe reproduction of blueprints, travel time, copies, was all an additional to this base price for things that are not part of the capital projects, though. So them developing the capital project, providing us with that literature documentation, that's in their bid. But we asked them to come out to do another service. If they needed to do drawing for the crack in the wall, that would be additional, every part of that.
High school building and renovated probably four of the buildings while I was still in Mifflin County, and we had Reynolds Construction manager on all of them. There was a separate architect, so construction manager was brought in to oversee the construction and to really make sure things were, from a day-to-day basis, watched and monitored on the construction site. Much more than one architectural firm would do. So that was their role for us, was specifically construction management. Project was put in place by the architect, was bid by the architect, and then Reynolds came in and oversaw the construction of that project. They did a fine job for us. We didn't have any problems with them on any of our projects, but like we said, we, in Mifflin County, we had one superintendent that, I think his title was superintendent, that we liked and we requested and we got him for every one of our projects, because it was the guy that we liked and we had a connection with, and we knew that he went the extra mile, you know, all the time for us. So it really has to do with who's on site.
Is that something that you can negotiate, obviously, is who you get, right?
Well, I think you could. I think the gentleman that I know worked out of their Harrisburg office and worked on in the other side of that side of the city. So I don't know that, you know, he would be available. I'm not even sure if he's still working anymore. So I don't know Reynolds enough to be able to say, hey, I want this, you know, this person that you have, and to know what we were getting.
Because I know that conversation happened with Dewey too, that there's some people. So you gotta make sure you get a good person no matter which company you choose.
Sure.
So Jim, good question.
So each one would take how long?
I think we would schedule 45 minutes. Does that seem fair? A 30, 15?
I've seen that, and you want at least 15 minutes to talk amongst ourselves,
yep,
before it gets away as well. It's at least an hour per interview, right, typically. It becomes a long night if we're doing more than 40.
Well, I wouldn't mind interviewing